Good evening to everyone. Welcome out to our third Thursday lecture series. This is an annual event. My name is William Dudley. I'm the Vice President of Internal Affairs of the Student Government Association. I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight to hear a powerful brother by the name of Steve Coakley speak on some topics that everybody might not want to know about but need to be said. At this time, I'm going to bring TC Muhammad up, and he's going to carry the rest of the program.
Peace. How's everyone doing? Peace.
Peace.
Assalamu alaikum. Praise the Lord. Hotel. What's going on? I'd like to up here and do the purpose and the reason why we started the Third Thursday Lecture Series. But I think at this juncture, one of the things I wanted to say, there were brothers and sisters that started this or had the vision and idea for it, but it's because of student leadership, primarily the Student Government Association, that is the student leaders that were elected by the student body that allows us to use the student funds to fund functions like this. And I have to say that because they didn't have to allow this to continue to go on each year. It's been going on for at least 7 years. For the particular students that come, this brother's been here before. He's very controversial everywhere he goes, but no one has stopped him from coming because of the student support for this master's degree. And I thank the student government for allowing this to continue to grow, because if it wasn't for their efforts, this particular lecture would not be going on. Also, wanted to also thank the brothers and sisters from the community for coming, because one of the things that we don't want to do at ANT is make ourselves an elitist set of leaders group, where we're not part of the community and we're separate from the community. So we always wanted to open this up to the student body. Student funds are for the students, and we also want to share our student funds with the community and let them have the privilege of hearing the lectures that we bring on this campus. And I also want to thank all of the colleges that have come, and the ones that I know, you can correct me if some more here. I know UNCG, GTCC, and of course my strong Bennettdale sisters are here. I know some brothers and sisters from Raleigh and Durham showed up tonight. And we got some people coming from Winston-Salem that are here. And we got Sister Kim Denmark that's walking across the country with a crew. You know, dealing with welfare reform and dealing with a whole lot of issues like the Hope Sits issue. She's here with us tonight to partake in our discussion. I thank her for coming. And I say this because one of the things that we want to do tonight, and I want to make sure, is that before everyone leaves, we can start listening back, emails, phone numbers, so that we can keep a network going. I have one, and a lot of people I know, but we want to make sure that matches like this, not only here, in the other cities and across the country, because I do travel a lot, that we know about certain events that are going on. One of the events that I attended in Atlanta, the State of the Black World Conference, it was a big national meeting, but there wasn't a whole lot of influence put on it for a lot of people being there, for a lot of our national, from the African Central Radical Revolutionary to Jesse Jackson. You know, all the way from that special was there, but it wasn't really communicated to the grassroots. Couple of events that are coming up. Next week, right here in the Vigil Hall from 9 to 5 on Wednesday, we're going to have our Vendors Village. And this is where we have vendors from the community coming in to display their arts, their whatever they have to sell. And if anyone wants to be a part of the Vendors Village, if you have a pen and paper, I'll give you the number where you can call the brother. And that number is 253-6086. That's 253-6086 if anyone want to be a vendor for next week on Wednesday. Also, Bennett College, every Thursday at 7 p.m. at Clare Hall. Every Thursday at 7 p.m. at Clare Hall, they have a books group on the book study called Know Thyself. And we study the book, Miseducation of the Negro by Carter G. Woodson. We have great discussions on the book and other issues that are pertinent to what's going on at this particular time in our life. So if not only for the sisters, brothers are welcome to come. Just stop by the guardhouse and make sure you check in and come on over to Clarion Hall for our book study. It's a real, real good book study. Also, we was playing a little bit of Gil Scott Heron when we started. So we know we like poetry and we like good poetry. And so a group called The Wordsmith, next Friday, we'll be having a poetry reading at Borders Bookstore. And I think it starts at 8 o'clock. And that's next Friday, Borders Bookstore. And also in Durham, every second Friday, they have what we call the site. A critical analysis of what you have heard to see if that's something that you need to use in your life. But we need strategies for survival, strategies for warfare, strategies to eat, and strategies to do things to live. And we don't have the proper food for that from a good food out of the earth. And we don't even know how to buy earth instead of buying Lexus. You know, we need to come to Lexus where we learn how to do these things. So one of the first lessons that we brought back when we started in 1994 with our former student government president, Keith Bryan, one of the things that was going on, anytime that you rise up to have a revolution, there's counter-revolution to your revolution. There's what we call, you know, in the 50s and 60s, COINTELPRO, counterintelligence program. What else counterintelligence is going on to stop the process of this taking place on this campus? And it was not only from administrators, it was also from students that didn't want to see this kind of program going on. So Brother Copeland breaks this down. He deals with a broad subject. He's going to talk about what he wants to talk about tonight. But he's the person that talks about the secret societies, the New World Order. He's the man that names the names. When you talk about the Rothschilds and Rockefellers, he gives us a picture of how to fight when we deal with the power dynamics. You don't want to fight the flunky when the flunky don't have the power. So we need to fight, and we're going to fight effectively, knowing who to fight in the struggle for Black liberation. So at this time, I'm going to yield the mic and let our brother present his own way. And also, before we leave here tonight, I want everybody to also meet Dr. Mack. He's here too. Dr. Mack, can you stand? And meanwhile, I want you to see here. The strongest supporter of Third Thursday. He allows his class to come in for extra credit. And he's been here from the start since 1994. He was on the mall at the Million Man March from 2 a.m. until the time that we got back on the bus and left with us. And Dr. Mack has always supported this, even if he's one of the biggest commentators of the Third Thursday, that he's always here every year. And I love him, and he's one of our elders. I thank you for coming. I thank everyone for coming. And at this time, give it up for Brother Steve Copeland. All right, buddy.
Okay, Doctor. I appreciate the opportunity. Just going to have another little technical capability. We'll be using television screens. I'm glad brother spent a little time working with the televisions to hook them up so we can run stuff simultaneously, and we'll see if we can get it. We can make some points here. I see some friends in the house, some of my old friends. A lot of things we've been doing together over the years. We'll see if this will work out. I'll use some of this too. All right, then, that one. Is that on? No. There we go. We get a chance to share some information. I appreciate the opportunity. All right. Need to work a lot of this equipment up here. All right. Some Star Wars electronics. All right. Yeah, we get to work some of the equipment. See if we can make some clarity. Give a little status report on African people. Give a little conversation about some of the things going on up ahead. There are some things we could not talk about. You know, people say, well, brother, what are we going to do? Well, we were going to do it successfully. It's likely you wouldn't tell just anybody about it because they haven't committed themselves to be a part of it. So for what we can do, we're going to do the best we can. One thing I want you to remember, if you wouldn't forget anything else, right now, America is all over the world checking out the value and the impact of education. What they're fighting in the Al-Qaeda or the Taliban is freedom fighting school. At the end of going to those schools, people would go away and plan and plot and strategize against a foe that never believed it could ever sustain an attack. And they did it in their own schools. And when America got to Afghanistan, they saw little children with calendars with Osama bin Laden on the back. And they said, we're going to have to take over these schools. The first act of the new Afghan government was to take state control over all schools. That's the key. The children were targeted by the government after the military. For the children were going to spring and keep springing. People who thought
we were doing together over the years to see if this will work out, use some of this too. All right, then, is that on?
There we go. We get a chance to share some information. I appreciate the opportunity. All right. Need to work a lot of this equipment up here. All right. Some Star Wars electronics. All right, yeah, we'll get to work some of the equipment. See if we can make some clarity. Give a little status report on African people. Give a little conversation about some of the things going on up ahead. There are some things we cannot talk about. You know, people say, well, brother, what are we going to do? Well, we were going to do it successfully. It's likely you wouldn't tell just anybody about it because they haven't committed themselves to be a part of it. So for what we can do, we're going to do the best we can. One thing I want you to remember, if you wouldn't forget anything else. Right now, America is all over the world checking out the value and the impact of education. What they're fighting in the Al-Qaeda or the Taliban is freedom fighting school. At the end of going to those schools, people would go away and plan and plot and strategize against a foe that never believed it could ever sustain an attack. And they did it in their own schools. And when America got to Afghanistan, they saw little children with calendars with Osama bin Laden on the back. And they said, we're going to have to take over these schools. The first act of the new Afghan government was to take state control over all schools. That's the key. The children were targeted by the government after the military. For the children were going to spring and keep springing, people about the fact that change is inevitable based on how you operate. But many people who give more credit to hatred, deceit, colonialism, and white supremacy than it has coming, always believed that it was beyond reproach. When they asked Colin Powell, why didn't you offer inhibit the attack at the World Trade Center? He said, we knew about you. We knew the people. We had targeted the players. He said, but I didn't think they had the audacity to try it. Audacity came out of freedom fighter school, out of training. It came out of preparation and planning, came audacity. That they would go ahead and pick a target and attack that target. What have we learned since 9/11? Well, we learned that a 15-year-old white boy, 3 Sundays ago, and I'll take that back because it's time passed on, came up with that. Maybe he wasn't white, maybe he was Palestinian father, who was a part of a kicked out of Israeli Knesset. And that this little boy jumped in that airplane. Does anybody know what the little boy flew over before he crashed into what building? Because America didn't want to say what building for a while. What building did the boy crash into? Colorado. Bank of America. supporting Monica Lewinsky him down. Because she was a swallow, she was an Israeli intelligence asset. And they call swallows female lures. They call ravens male lures. In the book that talks about the formula of the Israeli Mossad sending Lewinsky type women all over the country. Somebody put one in my household. They sent them all across. I told you about Brother Colin. He got caught down to one person in the room with him. Everything went wrong from that point on. But the Israeli Knesset, the Mossad sent these people all over the world, their lures, take down the target. And they took them in less than a week from this total administration. They cut a deal, let's get out of the pocket, but he had to go to Harvard. When the World Trade Center bombing went down, Clinton walks out the office.
Away and it's 21 minutes away, that's minus 10. Now, some of the highest
world looked at that plan, stamped it, and chucked it away, and said, this safely secures downtown D.C. So, what did we learn from 911 as late as 2 weekends ago? America still ain't really prepared for nothing because audacity in their hearts has run out. When they asked Colin Powell, you knew it was coming, why didn't you stop it? He said, we never thought they had the audacity. And I reiterate that the audacity came from freedom fighters training. Now, something happens that when we leave college, we don't seem to be pissed off. We leave college seeking opportunity from those who, in fact, assassinated opportunity in our relatives, our ancestors, in our neighborhood, at our hospitals, at our schools. We seek the approval and the employment of those people who, if we had confrontation, would be viewed as an enemy. When you left school, like going to a Holocaust conference, well-educated, well-taught, y'all would be pissed off. Y'all would be pissed off. Damn, I'm pissed off. But I just graduated. Because that's what someone who learned what really happened would feel like. I'm going to show you tonight when they bring the Masonic Bible for George Bush Jr. to be sworn in on. Why they bring him a Masonic Bible for the president to put his hand on? Then they call the names of other people who use the same Bible. What do that mean? What's going on there? We'll look a little bit at the ritual of Skull and Bones. George Bush, Skull and Bones president. The junior and the daddy. Now wait now, they killed 2 Kennedys to stop them from building a dynasty in the presidency. How did they let these 2 boys get by and not get killed? They killed John, and they killed Robert, and they knocked Edward out of the plane, and Jack acquitted him to keep that family from building a dynasty, but the Bush family built one. How could that happen? What were the forces that killed a Kennedy that accepted a Bush? Now, wait just a minute here. Last I heard, all bags of pretzels are under investigation. Especially the brown ones. Could you imagine you over there blowing up half the world? You sitting at home with 2 dogs and you damn near kill yourself from a pretzel? Or maybe that's not what happened at all. I got the front page of Washington Post, that scar upside his face ain't about no falling on no carpet and hitting your head 1 second and waking back up. Now he said the only other person in the White House with him was who? His wife, who was in another room. Anybody know our history? She killed the man. She killed the man. You don't know the history of Bush's wife. You don't know that she killed a man, called self-defense, and let it go. You don't know nothing about that? Shit, I ain't gonna worry about that. I ain't giving her 1,000. They're talking about 70,000 a year and stuff. I know this is an intuition, ain't it? Who I believe this is an intuition, ain't it? Yeah. Y'all better check out history. Anybody else need a rock? I see them standing around the back. Now, y'all come down the middle here. It's all I'm saying. I don't need to take it like this now. We had that first million youth march in New York. We had that first million youth march in New York. There were 400,000 people out there. And in 6 minutes, Brother Collar, he militarized them. In other words, Giuliani and the 4,000 police were about to attack these 400,000 people who had assembled under the banner of the million youth march. I was standing right next to Brother Collin. I spoke right before Brother Collin gave only a 6-minute speech because Giuliani was going to attack at 4, and Collin wanted to talk just right before 4 o'clock. And when he told them people unlock them barricades and stand and decide amongst you now who will stand up and fight if the police attack our families, you can see people switch out the whole front. You can see people decide who was going to fight. And then you can hear them rattling. Heard these chairs rattle. You can hear those gates unravel. Anybody been up in Harlem in New York? And these long barricade gates. If you saw them New Year's Eve and you see them, these big police crowds. control things in New York. It's almost like a zoo up there, the way they play it. They have all these long rapid fences. And you can hear people unlock those gates and prepare to fight. And in 6 minutes, they were ready to fight. And when that fight started, we began to go off the stage of college and then went out the back of the stairs, and the stage stairs just collapsed as the police and everybody started fighting. I can show you on videotape when them policemen with guns, we looked at me at once. They were backing up because when they saw people wanted to fight them and they had guns and sticks, they backed up. Because any military that sees that the people will fight even when they're outnumbered recognizes that there aren't enough bullets to hold back the bullet people. So they tend to back off that. One of the most profound revolutions in the history of the world is the Iranian Revolution. My hero raising up was Ayatollah Khomeini, who used cassette tape to raise the consciousness of the slave Iranian people by the Shah of Khomeini stopped. Because nobody would be a slave for the Shah on the day Khomeini put it on the tape. That's all. That's all. He wasn't even in town. He was in France. They snuffed the tapes. They snuffed the tapes around the village till the people caught up with what was the plan, who was the enemy, what was the target. When I stand up and say it's an all or nothing strategy, and we're going to free our kids from the jail called compulsory education, anybody that runs a country knows if you break the chain of oppression, which is a mental shackle given by the socialization of education. Education is the key to controlling a society. It is the cornerstone. You only use the military when you have to, and you only use religion when you need to. But you starve with education. When we've been going around doing these destroying public education committees, we ask people, go and find out how public education started in your area. It was illegal for us to read. It was illegal for us for two or more to get together and to talk in our own language. So where and when did education start? And when we start breaking away, go around and check the history of African school. There was no white school until you began to put school out. And when you put school out, they came out with public schools. Damn, that tells me something. That when you started school and came to New York, African school turned into public school. Wasn't public school in African school. Because Africans figured out getting free, they needed to know some things. So they started their own schools. Then the Rockefellers, the Sloan Ketterings, the Rothschilds, the Rosenwalds, they all began to take their foundation money and start buying secondary education, building primary school buildings, training thousands of teachers and putting them out into the schools, because then the whites have to say, we're going to give this Negro an education. How can we decide that we're going to give him one, and at the end of that, he will be pissed off? Because if he know we raped his mom, and he know we speed his daddy down, knocked him out of everything, used our mafia in the back door and our banks in the front door to knock him down, how can we teach him something and keep him safe? So they came up with educational scientists. How can you tell the truth and say it in a way, yeah, Columbus didn't discover America, he killed the people. Okay, fine, you're all. Hey, okay, so we killed the so-called Indios people, and we call it Thanksgiving. How do we get them to get off that day and not be pissed off? That's some heavy shit. You can pull that off. How can 415,000 people get laid off since September and nobody pissed off? See, I was in Chicago. We had steel mills all across the lake. They laid off 1.5 million people. The taverns, the bars, the grocery stores, all in that area got destroyed. And when nobody pissed off, they were laying off all those auto workers. They got up in Detroit. I was just in Detroit a couple weeks ago and reminded them when the frustrated auto workers got pissed off and beat up a Chinese man because they thought he built a Honda. They were beaten with clubs. Misplaced aggression. America knows they can turn that back and never get targeted. The most embarrassing thing they had to deal with was that there was a population that hated it and said it to its face. Because everyone else hated it and worked for it. That logic. You gotta break that chain. It's a mental lock that makes you think it's okay to be both of you. whites and blacks. It's going between poor whites and rich whites. I predict to you today that within the next 5 years, the poor white community is going to physically attack the downtown populations of America, and the poor whites are going to fight the rich whites, and in the process, they're going to neutralize each other and free the Negro.
Yeah.
So if the Negro were to prepare for the thought that they will whip the whites, not because it's a race war, but because those people who own and control the banks and insurance companies, run the shams at Arthur Anderson, run the shams at Enron, run the shams at the White House, they're all white men predominantly. There's no doubt about it. And a few Negroes like Chuck Parsons out of New York, who's running downtown Warner, sits on the board of Howard University, where 1996, when I'm going to speak there, Big Dick Parsons decided I'm too black to talk to the black employees doing African History Month. So he writes a memo to Sylvia Rome, the top black woman in the record business, to tell her to shut me down. We went downtown and shut down the Rockefeller Center. We shut it down, round the building, shut it down. Nobody spoke about that speech. And when they went to Susan Taylor, who run Essence Magazine, to replace me, she called me and said, boy, them white folks are afraid of you. I don't know who you are. She said, with Jesse Jackson, they didn't do nothing. This week they're paying you $2,000 an hour just to replace you. I don't even know who you are. Sharpton tells me I'm a comic star. He's a Boule monster. She said, what is the Boule? Which is the black male secret society, even the president of school. But that's the black male secret society. Now check out the trip. She says, Mr. Coley, I want you to send me every take you ever done on the Boule. I might have 2 or 3 hours in the night. She said, send me every tape you got. Some stock, I'll call, I need the money. Comes about $2,300, Brother Clarence, I wanted to know. But some lock in the universe didn't allow me to empower her with my information, because when I snuck into the next Boule convention, there she was. Susan Taylor as the main speaker. And her boyfriend printed the Boule Journal, their quarterly magazine. She told me she knew nothing about it. And if money was my dad, I would have gave her our whole cars. We said we'd never write a book about the Boule, so we stole this ritual book. So finally I can stand here and hold it up. Got the Boule ritual book. Now, many times I argued with these people and they swore to things that, you know, hey, it ain't satanic. You know, I had this little discussion last May with Asa Hilliard, who's a member of the secret society, who's a very involved African man. He does some good things for African people. And we had this debate at this conference in Atlanta, educational conference in the Garvey School, and I said, some brothers asked him about it. He said, Boule ain't secret, it ain't nothing, just a bunch of old men getting together. And then another sister from Oakland, she brought it up, and how could you be into this? He said, it ain't nothing, why you in it? It ain't nothing, it ain't secret, all my names are public, this and that. And everybody's trying to really knock it out in front of me, but I'm the one who really should ask the questions, because I'm better prepared to deal with when he starts to pull the answers. So the first answer was, nothing we do is secret. So then, having already stole the Boule ritual book, now how we got this Boule ritual book is that the Boule archives at Fisk University, you know, down in Nashville. So we get down to the library, they got a special little room with glass encased. And it must have been a 90-year-old sister in there working. She could barely move. She was the keeper of the records of the Boule, the top black male secret society. I mean, these people are the people who link to the top whites. When I was trying to teach people about trilateral commission, Bilderberg group, the coming of the Euro, the European Parliament, people, huh, what? But when I found the black guys that hooked to the white guys, everybody went, oh, yeah, I got it now. So that helped us be able to affirm people that there's an agenda for America. It got nothing to do with the president. And when the agenda don't work, it's when I stole the damn election. A year ago right now, we're in January. A year ago right now, they were still arguing over the red states versus the blue states. I don't want you to forget that, because how Bush got in the position of making this war was he stole the government. Let me hear you say, stole the government. See, if you was in school and somebody stole the government, and somebody else ain't plowing the vote, you ought to be pissed off. See, that's what I'm saying. All them black people was at Florida A&M. schools in session, everything going fine. Nobody gets pissed off that America. I keep them from getting pissed off. The Bush family is the largest financial connection to the Osama bin Laden group. That ought to piss you off. Because why you run around and shut down the plans for the Palm Beach Committee for the donations? He ought to be shutting down the mall down in Houston called the Galleria. Anybody here from Houston? Anybody here from Houston? Anybody know about the Galleria Mall? One of the largest malls in Houston? That's Osama bin Laden built that damn mall. Between Houston and Prairie View, there's an airport base just got sold to the Osama bin Laden. They're gonna build another mall. Now, how come they ain't raiding the banks of Texas who holding up the bin Laden group while they hunting down Muslims, shaking them down all over, asking all kind of weird questions? Now, I'm gonna read to you the questions that the FBI asking the Muslim men, like, where have you traveled, where are you going, who have you talked to, who do you know like September 11th, who do you know has the power to do anything, who's training? Who's talking? Who's everything? Probably get naked. You know, I went to the airport the other day. I said, yeah, man. I said, brother, see, they gonna make you take your clothes off. I said, fine, that's all right. So I said, brother, you're gonna have to take your clothes down. I said, yeah, that's fine. I took them down. I have no underwear on. Shoe thing, when the first report came out, light-skinned man in dreadlocks. See, I went, oh, yeah, light-skinned man, dreadlock in the shoes, I'm on the car. You know, you go to the airport now, you got a 50-minute flight, you get there 3 hours early, you get out an hour late, you spend 7 hours on a 50-minute flight. That takes away the value of it. But one thing that happened as a result of 9-1-1 I would never want you to forget, is that we used to fight every year for economic sanctions against non-black businesses as a demand, under demand for justice. Now, the economy has automatically slowed down. Now, there's nobody doing no business with nobody. 40, 50, 60% business down. It just came through the bread and butter of white economy is November, December, January. That 60% of everything is in 3 months. What just happened this November, December, and January? You just boycott that stuff. You slow down and don't buy it, prices will go down. So said, but how come if they sell less of it, why will prices go down if they sell less of it? Said, because to sell it, the whole sales game is called con for this. Hey, Bush is gonna, he's got to pump up the economy as a result of September 11th. Bush plan emphasizes what? Bush's plan emphasizes confidence. What is confidence? Confidence is that if I give you a dollar, it means 100 pennies. That the money still, I heard a white man say, how's stability in the neighborhood? He said, well, as long as we don't turn off these ATMs, as long as the liquor store and the grocery store are still open, we in business. That's that. Well, they did shut the ATMs down for a minute or two. Y'all be in there 4 or 5 times a day, get $20 out of the stand. I'll spend $30, not $20. But confidence is a part of the game. So we down in the fist, and the sister, we down there looking at some books and stuff, and the sister says, look, I got to go to the bathroom, but you young men watch this stuff for us, for me. Said, sister, you better believe it. We got it covered. Look, sister, went to the bathroom. We got a Boulay Ritual 19, a Boulay Ritual 1937, revised 83, and on and on and on. This is the 37 cover. Now, once we stole the stuff, once we copied it, we took it back. Because we want them to have that stuff. We just want to look at it. So we took that stuff. And little did I know was that the Boulay had degrees. Now, for those of you who are looking at me wondering, what is this damn Boulay? Just simply, it's the state of Black America. Check this out now. Y'all tell me if I'm true. Since 9-1-1, the Civil Rights All-Stars have been on vacation. See, these Negroes used to fight for the rest. Me So this thing called Mu Lega Sigma Pi Phi, it's the black male secret society started in 1904. It's known now in every major city in this country because Brother Steve and the people that I taught make that so. And if anybody stands up and tell you how, without telling the story, I'm going to tell you what that since I've seen Brother Copeland, that's what's going to happen. We're coming through y'all and also CIA stuff. As soon as I leave, it's going to happen. Now y'all hear this character. Someone said, man, that damn Steve Copeland was down there talking all this shit, man. Talking all that shit, nigga, didn't even have no teeth.
Fish, I guarantee you, you'll be popular in your neighborhood.
or authorized you or certified you, which is a very dangerous condition, seeking certification. That's the Freedom Fighters Hall of Fame, that's a sickness. Seeking certification. And we'll talk about that later. Anyway, so we got us some Kool-Aid ritual books, and we found some interesting things in it. And it's going to lead me right back to those circles in the White House and the 15-year-old boy in the airplanes. In the Kool-Aid ritual book, we found them swearing never to reveal anything on the death of their mama, on the ripping of their tongue, and, you know, statements like this. Do you accept the purposes? Do you still wish to continue your quest for membership in this council? Answer yes or no. Then you will kneel before this body. What is kneeling? It's a symbolic act of submission. You will kneel before this body. Here assembled and repeat after me the sacred oath of the council. It's right out of the Kool-Aid ritual book. In the first degree, this is the top of Black Greek organizations. This is before AKA, before Delta, before Alpha, before Q, before all of that. There was this. And on that foundation, this is their conversation. I, in the presence of this council here assembled, do hereby promise and swear never to reveal in any way, in any manner, the mysteries, the secrets, the tokens, or the rites of this body. Now, the only thing that meant to me was that there are mysteries, there are secrets, there are tokens, and rites of the body. So when Asa Hilton says, we don't do nothing secret, but they take a oath pledging never to reveal something secret, I have what you call that ultimate contradiction. Where Jesse, we jumped on Jesse for going to the council for relations. What's up, cuz? He said, I've never really been to a meeting, but I spoke at some of them. That's a contradiction. I couldn't quite figure that out. Hey, my your uncle over there. I've never met him before, but that's my daddy's brother's son. And I never met him until I came down here for a lecture at the No Bookstore. What's up?
Got on the trial, found convicted, and for her,
see her stride in that surge. I was very proud of her. But when I got a little closer on the King family and got near the sons and into the other children and family members, now, the point of this is the state of the African community is this. How many of you all have heard of something called COINTELPRO? But we found in a vault of information that we had a chance to get to. We got to this information because we earned the right to be in pursuit of what it said, and when looking for it, it just opened up. That's a metaphysical question. If you choose to be in the vanguard of assisting and fighting on behalf of your people, though you may never figure out how is the way will be made if you desire. You must desire it, and the way will be made. But you know what they usually tell me is, "Brother Oakley, I'm really with you, man. Man, I'm gonna leave you down at work. You can look dull and get the house on time, the car, have the kids, and get everything straight, and I'm gonna be back." I'm gonna say, "Brother, that's the struggle right there. You live and die trying to win." Another sidebar before I get back to this King thing is, in any lecture I ever gave, when somebody asked me about government, special assistant for the mayor of Chicago. In fact, I got the CNN Crossfire program that I showed here last time I was here. Why debated Irv Rubin of the JDL, who just got arrested a month ago for plotting to blow up the office of a Muslim legislator and to blow up the Muslim mosque. And Colin was the case, he's got a real fight for all over the place. He was in Riverside when Colin got shot in 95. And so this guy is, he's out. Post office, because I fantasize. What's up, man? That's a little joke. Somebody come down now, they come too far. I got to prepare. Even though that's my best brother, it brought me to North Carolina Central. And so I know who he is, but I still got it. Because sometimes it can only be who you know. Profound African people used to walk up to our people and go, "Man, I feel and see your aura." Now, 2 weeks ago, white folks get a machine. Now, finally, white folks can read it too. So they come out with this new mind that, did you see this thing? Where they put this machine up in your face and it shows that your eyes and other things radiate in a way that signals how you're feeling. But I'm telling you, when I was raised up, these were special people in our neighborhood who used to read your aura. But white folks never could do it. I used to tell them they can't do it. But now they got a machine, they can do it. So now they acknowledge that it's true. But when they couldn't do it, they couldn't acknowledge it. Only you. And we allowed them to cut us off. Where we were extraordinary, we became just an ordinary. And we cut off that thing that allowed us to see right through shit. Well, we cut it down. I'll bring back ordinary, or mother went in the highest level. We could do that, and we let them cut way back. But anyway, before we get on to this scene, I was trying to tell you something about Nan Monroe that I thought was important about the post office. I love the post office. Again, imagine if you had a message. Back during the election for Harold Washington for mayor, who was a black mayor of Chicago, long since murdered, we could get all the literature out to all of the locations. We knew there were some locations we couldn't get to. So we did something that was absolutely illegal. We went to the loyal postal workers who were our friends and gave the postal worker the literature. He saw that the Washington literature got in every mailbox because it was his job to go in every mailbox. But it's illegal for a postman to carry non-mail items. in you in a revolution. Not a revolution is anything you want to try. And we won. And in them areas where the machine had precinct captain, deputy captain, triple captain, corporal captain, just the mailman wheel and the right man on the message. So I went all the mail, because they go to everybody. Imagine this. You want to know how big America is? The Postal Service goes at every house, in every door of all of America, every damn day. That's some awesome shit. I go, man, I almost came.
Yeah.
stop an invasion of Africa. So when I'm in LA last week, I called your call from DC, man, they can stop TV live to announce America got the reconnaissance planes over Somalia and got the troops in the ships off the water just waiting to go. In LA, in an even LA Times, they talk about Grammys, they talk about Blockbuster Awards, they talk about J-Lo, and they talk about Mariah Carey. So all that population is neutralized on another theme. But I go in there and watch that Black Hawk down, and I see them Africans with them American soldiers, and I see them set that movie up, any white American will go, them damn Africans, they did that. When Americans, now the movie opens up with announcing America wants to go in and kill this African tribal leader. That in itself is illegal. Just straight up, but this ain't about the law. It's about white supremacy. And white supremacy, there is no law to protect a black man from a white man with a mission. So don't go running to no law. Go get your weapon.
Subordinate population, the use of someone to fulfill a higher need.
and that's that they would be sacrificial lambs, or they would be March Madness. That's when they burned all the animals as a form of killing a disease. Don't forget that. Now in May, the right Senator Jeffries, now this was a deal. I'm going to tell you this is in. This will never be in a history book. This will never be on paper. But this is exactly what happened. I'm telling you now straight up. Bush stole the election and they knew they could catch him. The woman that ran the butterfly ballot used to work for a man named Adam Khashoggi. Adam Khashoggi was the man who led the arms for hostages peace with Iran, Reagan, and Bible, all these other people that kept the hostages locked up so Obama lost the election and Reagan won. The whole point of that is that Adam Khashoggi is the American business representative of Osama bin Laden. So you've got someone who worked for him, moves into politics, comes up with the butterfly ballot, they knock the students out in Tallahassee, they neutralize them down in South Florida, Bush carries Florida. But wait, the Bushes aren't from Florida. They're not even from Texas. Daddy Bush was senator from Connecticut. How the hell did they get down there? Oh, hold it now. If you count 60 and you count 25 and you count 40 and you count 3, 6, 7, 11, you could actually steal the government if you plan 10 years in advance. You can send your sons to states of high electoral votes. And you can steal the election, and other rights will reward you for your cunning nature. So they did that. And they used the nine hoods to steal it. Never before did they have to bring out the nine most racist people in America to steal the government. So now they're cleaning them up. They're going to clean the Supreme Court up for stealing that election. So it'll be on tomorrow for the second time. It's called First Monday. It just came on this week, First Monday, the new CBS TV show about the humane, conscientious Supreme Court. James Gardner, got some Negro playing Clarence Thomas. Joe Magnateri, what's that? A Magnateri dark-haired guy. He's been advertising his face all week as the new justice on the court. And I watched that the other day, and what number of propaganda to clean up that them nine groups would steal anything they had to protect white supremacy. And when all the black people ran to Gore and said, help us, help us, Gore said, look, I'm going to tell y'all straight up, I'm a white guy. And the way you make it in this world as a white guy is you never upset another white guy's victory. I mean, after all, I'm a white guy. Now, see, if a black guy won, I got to fight because I might not get nothing, but a white guy won, I'm tired of the heart. I'm tired of all that attention anyway. Shit, I could go out to grow a beard and get a girlfriend. Right? He knew he wasn't going to win when he got Lieberman because that unites the whole South against anything Democratic. That's Saad. They put out Saad, Zionist occupational government, and whether Lieberman was or wasn't in it, they dogged out and united the whole South for Bush. Even though they wasn't winning, it was better than Gore and Lieberman because that represented something that could never happen. You know, Chris Rock once said, if we ever had a black vice president, I'd kill the president. All right. You understand? One person shooting the president makes a vice president, but a nation you gotta vote for. You understand that? Know your points. So Chris Rock says, if a black person ever became vice president, I'd murder the president. What would happen then? I'd be a black president, right? Until what? Force to enforce the truth. Truth and force go together. But just truth, just the law. Fact check is out. One of the reasons we be jumping on the Negro leadership is that every time something happens, they say, call the Justice Department. Hey, the civil rights office, call the Justice Department. Hey, if they kill Natasha Arnold, call the Justice Department. If they beat Rocky, call the Justice Department. So Justice Department just came out with a report saying, you can call me if you want. Write this down. Washington Post, August 21st, 2001. Police rarely charged in federal probes. Just 1.5% of all civil rights complaints the U.S. record shows. Out of 17,000 complaints brought to the Justice Department over civil rights violations, 17,000, the Justice Department only prosecuted 2%. Let me hear you holler, 2%.
2%.
Say it again.
2%.
Say it again.
2%.
So the next time somebody be around you and they holler, bring in the Justice Department, what you gonna say?
2%.
They gonna say, what? And you gonna say, yeah, that's how often they come to prosecute the complaints that are brought to them, and 1% is the amount they convict. And then they gonna say, call in the Justice Department anyway, and you go, you are the Justice Department. I knew that now. Because how can I tell you it don't work when you say still go to it? So that's the civil rights and all stars being a thing. Call in the Justice Department. Yes. Oh, 24 with Kiefer Sullivan about the counterterrorism unit that's gonna stop a California senator who's running for president, right? He's a black guy. Now somebody asked me how that thing 24 was gonna work out. They gonna kill him. They gonna kill the Negro with the clip. Because the last man who won California on his way to the presidency was Rock Kennedy, and they shot him right there in a hotel in LA. And I saw that, and this is a lot of life. They use TV, got the agency on, CIA everywhere. Seeing how much they use disguises, phony passports, phony identities, corrupt bank accounts, hiding intel, that movie Spy Game with Brad Pitt and Robert Redford. There's a lot of deep things in that movie that are hidden within the movie about how intel works. When the director comes in, how he calls people up to brief him about the status of things. Never underestimate that process by which they work to run the world. You can dissect that process. You can begin to be a benefactor of the complicated nature, but they tie themselves up with their own plans and strategies that make it difficult for them to run and manage their own world. Yes, sir. No, I didn't. That's about the internet and some stuff. Yeah.
Obviously.
No, just say about it. Tell them what the movie means.
Well, basically, it's about there's a figure like Bill Gates. And what he's doing is, he's like trying to be, he wants to take over the whole Microsoft, the whole realm of that thing. And what you see with that is, me and my friend right here, we were watching and we were putting it together. The twist on what we come at, how we watch things, he said, how movies show you how real life is about to take place or take effect. Now this movie came out maybe spring of last year, but anyway, it depicts a gentleman who gets all his information off of other people's internet usage, from their web pages to what they think, what they write, what they email to everybody else in the world, from California to Chicago. He comes up with this microcosm thing called Synapses, and it's basically a program that plays on what everybody's emotions and thinkings and what their feelings are. So it appeals to all nationalities, all races, all creeds. So on the flip side of that, how Mr. Coakley was speaking was, you know, basically I was saying how the beat, and I'm getting into this because I'm trying to get outside of my box way of thinking, how the beat is so big, and I'm going to sit down on this, it's going to take a high power to fight, but it's important that we all keep getting enlightened.
Natural causes.
He's told me that.
Have you looked like he didn't die?
No, you
brother Colin dies on Monday night, you don't look sick to me. You don't sound sick to me. Now, for any of you that are leaving early, if it's a date or something that you want, my daughter will be able to have you. Is anybody else interested in a rap ticket over that table for brother Colin? Got somebody out there. Just a dollar. My daughter move around. She gets her. Where do you put your feet? What do you think about? All right, now, I know everybody got to go because they got to go. But I want to start showing you some stuff. Let you know what a rare opportunity this is that we have when we get to be together. So I make you something good.
Who was a Mason?
who was put on the black talk show couch. Went to circle right down to his eye. 2 days later, he was fired. Very important thing.
Senator John Kerry, John Kinchy, too. and three presidents, William Taft, George Bush, and George W. Bush, who's been reluctant to talk about Skull and Bones.
But the show says, I'm going to make it so secret, I'm going to make sure the show says, the meeting you guys have had is not the end of the world, but a war on Skull and Bones.
Turned out to be one of my most valuable informants in the Black Pro program.
He was the first black Coleman foreman that I developed. BPI-18 was about 36 years old when I met her. I don't recall the specific circumstances under which I first talked to her. I learned very early on in my acquaintance with her that she, like most of the informants that I developed, came from a very large black family that had lived outside Atlanta while they were growing up. I had the need on bureau instructions of an informant that could report to me and make it possible for me to report to the bureau the activities of the Nation of Islam, known as NOI. That this black group that was established in the early 20s, which professed to be a religious group and were operating as a religious group professing the faith of Muslims. BPI-18 was able to join the NOI almost immediately and began attending many meetings at that time. I developed her as an informant. This was sometime in the mid-60s. Her reports were written to me at a post office box, which was maintained by the post office in downtown Atlanta. The reports were similar to the secretary reports given at a business meeting, church meeting, or any other type of meeting which she documented. What was said, what was done, who was at the meeting, what actions were taken, and all of the details of what was going on at the meeting of the Nation of Islam in Atlanta. I had her as an informant over a period of 7 to 8 years. She was able to confirm that the bureau was getting from all NOI headquarters of mosques, as they were called throughout the United States. Like, he goes on to say that having investigated them, they were not a hate group, they were not this, they were not that, but he was still told to spy on them. Because of the rules of the payment of informants, it was necessary for me to meet BP-118 at intervals to pay her in cash. The money was given in cash so that there would be no paper record by which anyone could prove that she had been an informant of the FBI. If the informant got in trouble, it was possible for the FBI to drop them and deny that they had any connection with them whatsoever. For this reason, I met BPI at various locations around Atlanta and gave her money. I also had, at time to time, give her separate assignments other than the Nation of Islam, and she attended numerous black groups around Atlanta that were activists in the civil rights movement during the 60s. One of the questions that I always asked an informant after I had worked with them from some time was, why do you wish to assist the FBI through me in this matter and report information on your own race? BPI-18 this question. One night, several years after we had worked together, we were parked in a parking lot in a slum area of Atlanta. It was just after dark. The parking lot was nearly empty, and she drove in and over and got into the bureau car. We just sat there talking for a while, and I asked her why she wanted to help me as an informant. She said, and just as I was asking her the question, we noticed that there were boxes going in. There were boxes going in from the front to the back of the barn. He's talking about these boxes. And it turned out there was rats moving the boxes. And she says, it's just like those boxes. You see, if it wasn't for the rats, the boxes couldn't move. So that's why I'm an informant, because if it wasn't for me, America couldn't work. Anyway, so I know. So as I know, I'll be telling people I get on the line, we just sustain it. We just remember Brother Collins is dead. Even again, all right. So that was a little interesting piece. On the King thing, Judge Joe Brown did the first, before he was sent to Hollywood, did the first episode of the rifle that James Earl Ray was supposed to use. Quote, when I got the case, I ordered the rifle that was supposed to be used to kill King to be retested, and I finally got it tested. The tests were rather conclusive. The rifling on the bullet was so wrong compared to the suspect's weapon, the electronic microscopy that was used for the analysis this time revealed that the bullet that was taken out of Dr. King was not fired from a rifle. In other words, he tested the bullet for the first time with a rifle and a bullet, and found out that the bullet not only didn't come out of that rifle, but it didn't come out of any other rifle, it came out of a handgun. There were two bullets in Martin King, one from a rifle and one from a handgun. Miss King goes to the Justice Department and accuses Jesse Jackson and the Reverend Billy Childs of Memphis of setting her husband up on the balcony for murder, and nobody in the country protects her. So the Justice Department Mr. Martin King. After interviewing more than 200 witnesses and reviewing material from four earlier investigations, the Justice Department concluded that King's killer, James Earl Ray, acted alone. Ray died in 98. But when it got to the little section investigating Jesse, something real funny happened. Ms. King said that Jesse met with the invaders at Sweet Canyon, which he did. He cleared them off the balcony. That's the balcony right there at that point when Martin's dead. Here's Jesse's picture right on top of here, one of the ones pointing. He runs down this side of the balcony because he got the invaders out of their room because they had guns and they might have shot across the street where they thought the killer was. But long story short, these are people standing, that's Martin King's body laying on the balcony. Long story short, the Justice Department says that they were not aware of Jesse Jackson even knowing that the invaders were in the hotel. So 15 minutes before the assassination, he couldn't have cleared them off the balcony because Jackson said he didn't know they were there when interviewed, and they have no known document showing that Jackson knew the invaders were there. And when I went to that vault that Ms. King let us in, there was an FBI document in there talking about Jesse Jackson meeting at the Lorraine Motel with the invaders. And how not only did he meet them, he helped them to get what room numbers they had, 315 and 316, right down the hall. Jesse didn't know the invaders were there, and the FBI got their own document showing that he met with them there only minutes before King died. So Ms. King looks up and goes, I did everything I could. Like that. They went out and killed him. That's the man who run the Osama bin Laden group. The Osama bin Laden group is connected with General Motors, connected with Citibank, is connected with General Electric, and is connected with Carlisle Group. I'm trying to think of another finance corporation that deals exclusively with Osama bin Laden group, which has got malls and property all over Texas. But get that roadblock cited in efforts to trace bin Laden's money. A six-year struggle to uncover Osama bin Laden's financial network failed. It says it failed because when it finally got down to who his American supporters were, one United States senator, chairman of the Senate Banking Committee, refused to allow the bill to come out of his committee. And he just happened to be the senator from Texas. Graham, Bill Graham, the senator from Texas, who before the deal, I was about to tell you about this deal, after they decided that nobody would defend the black voters in Florida, the Democrats were going to file a case against Floyd, so they cut a deal. They said, give us one white Republican senator from a state who won't suffer a backlash, Vermont, who can lead from the Republican Party and be an independent and throw the Senate to the Democrats. And if the Democrats were to receive the Senate as a part of the secret deal, they would not file any lawsuit to contest Bush's election. And you know how many lawsuits they filed to contest Bush's election? None. Because the deal was, you give us the Senate. And they gave the Democrats the Senate, then came the anthrax. That's chairman of the Senate. Bam, anthrax in his office. Kind of get the connection. Okay. And roadblock, six-year struggle to uncover failed because of the American officials did not skillfully use the legal tools they had. They did not realize they needed stronger weapons and face resistance at home and abroad. Federal officials say they have not persuaded foreign banks to open their books to investigators and that banks in this country, a law that would have allowed the U.S. to penalize these banks who did not cooperate, was blocked last year by a single U.S. senator, Bill Graham of Texas. How can Bush and them be so close to all this when the American embassy got blown up in Beirut? You know who America hired to rebuild it? The largest construction company in the so-called Middle East, the Osama bin Laden Group. How can you have this secret airplane leave Boston when all the planes had been shut down? The U.S. government had one plane fly out of Boston where all the relatives of Osama bin Laden were allowed this country for their own protection. And they're hunting down little people. Yes?
York. Then you got the Tower of Babel theory. You would
Then all of a sudden, fight breaks out at ground zero, and white crime and white policemen fight each other in the face.
That's right.
That's called the Tower of Babel theory, where they can get so united, rise so high, all of a sudden they can't hear each other, and they start to work against each other, though they swear they're on the same side. I said it's more likely that there'll be a white revolution in America where poor whites will fight, kill, and attack rich whites, and law will be suspended, outlawed. The only way you can have a revolution is to have no constitution. The only way you can have a revolution is to have no constitution. In the state of the race, African people went all the way over to Durban, South Africa, one of the homes of early white colonial settler racism, and heard white America say, I'm not even going to talk about slavery. I ain't going to talk to you about no reparations. I ain't going to talk to you about nothing. No Zionism is racism. And that was right before 9/11. Now in our community, you got people who are making a lifestyle out of reparation. Reparation ain't no liberation program. Just because you got reparation don't mean you got freedom. I'm looking for freedom. I ain't looking for no payout. Just pay us, cool us out. So I warn those reparation people. Don't get out in the forefront of African liberation and compromise liberation for reparation. Check? Now, this is America moving on the secret army. Watch them, y'all. If they start coming last, there must be some sacrifice. Y'all need to watch it. Watch this. Watch it. This is the invisible armies. How America is moving to make it look like heat coming up off the ground.
Many tools exist.
Not a legal weapon. So y'all the military is coming. What do they look like?
Or you can see the
cool. That's what I need to know. And if they get up with music, we should shut down.
We can just.
Being willing to have Brother Copeland. We're going to spend my cousin you saw was here, and I met him a couple of years ago for the first time. I'm up here talking about the Boule. My cousin's father was in the Boule. Now, I'm the main anti-Boule person in the whole United States. I get to Howard University Spingarn Library, and I'm digging down the names, and I see a name named Clarence Copley in Greensboro, North Carolina. C-O-K-E-L-Y, they ain't really Copeland's around like that. And Talladega College is built on my grandfather's land. They're still playing. In fact, when you come to tell me was that my uncle, who is the caretaker to our grandfather's estate, where Talladega College pays the family for the dormitories that are built on my granddaddy's land, is that my uncle had died yesterday. And that's what he had come to tell me, was that our uncle had died. And his parents, both of them are dead. Get killed in a car accident here in Greensboro. I go to Winston-Salem, doing a lecture on the Boule, and I see a guy named Big House Haynes. And I got the students with the camera because he's the Boule. I said, man, we're going to interview this dude. He's standing over there in the corner. And the little girl got the camera shaking. She said, I'm scared. And I said, Big House Haynes, I want to talk to you about the Boule. He said, oh, yeah, I'll build a chapter here in Winston-Salem. I come from Greensboro chapter. I said, you know what? He said, man, Clarence Copley was my best friend. I said, well, that was my uncle. I never met him. I never got a chance to meet my uncle. I never met my cousin until I came down here to the little bookstore, and everybody surprised me and brought him out from the back room. I had never met him before. And little all interesting that I'm getting to the bottom of a secret group, and it's my daddy's brother, isn't it? That's real deep. That's real deep. And they died before I got a chance to talk to him about it. But we were able to steal all our Boule information from other people. So we were able to help him read the information he had sitting around his house. But I thank the students here at North Carolina A&T for being strong enough to have a brother like me to even say things that are controversial and even can rub local dinosaurs raw. But I do appreciate
Once again, I'd like to thank everybody for coming out, especially people that came from other cities like Raleigh, Winston-Salem. And there's also a list going around so we can keep in contact, not only the stuff going on here, but stuff going on in other cities. My brother Dale Jones will be, I think, at the No Book Store next weekend, and he'll be at the Black Magnificent in Raleigh on next Sunday. Is there anybody want to check Dale Jones out? Also, tomorrow, Sister Pam Africa, Indefensible Male, Jamal, will be here